Now we are continuing our discussions and reading from the Jivadharma. We are on the 17th chapter. Brajanath has asked how many types of anarthas are there? And Babaji Maharaj has answered four types of anarthas. One is to think you're the body, one is to hanker for material enjoyment, one is to commit offenses, and one is to have a weak heart. Weak heart also means, I would say weak heart is synonymous with lack of intelligence, giving in to Maya, not clearly seeing things. So now he's going to go on to explain these four anarthas. And it's interesting because these anarthas are part of the conditioned nature. So it's not like in the conditioned state you have much control. You do have some control, but thinking we're the body is part of our conditioned existence. So, you know, until we're pure, we don't have much control. Well, I mean, we can act as a spirit soul, but we don't have a lot of control. And weakness of heart is also there due to ignorance, due to conditioning, that of lust, desire is part of our conditioning. Committing offense, we have more control over. I mean, in a sense, we have some control over all these, at least in terms of attitude, in terms of understanding. But most of these are well ingrained within our conditioned nature. And so the way we have control over them is by practicing sadhana. And then as we become purified, we overcome them. But anyway, wanted to read what he has said. The jiva's first anartha, namely Sarup Brahma, illusion about spiritual identity, is forgetting the understanding that, quote, I, the pure spiritual spark, am Krishna's servant, unquote, and being carried far away from his original spiritual position. So, yeah, that's... when you forget you're a servant, you are far away from your spiritual position. When the jiva considers that he and his dead material possessions are my and mine, he develops three types. So then he's going to the next one. Three types of asat Krishna, desire to enjoy temporary material pleasures. These are desires for a son, for wealth, for celestial pleasures. There are 10 types of aparad offenses. Those are nam-aparads, which I will discuss later. The jiva is grief-stricken because of hridaya dhorbayam, weakness of heart. These four types of anarthas are inherent in the jiva, who has been caught by ignorance, and they are removed gradually by cultivating Krishna consciousness in the association of shuddha bhaktas. So, what's interesting here is how he explains, as I was explaining, these four types of anarthas are inherent in the jiva who is caught by ignorance. In other words, the tendency to commit offenses to the holy name. Here he's describing offenses to the holy name as anarthas. And we had discussed in previous classes, offenses to Vaishnavas, to the Dham, and to the deity are also offenses. And here, interestingly, he's saying that when we're in ignorance, then offenses are inherent. We naturally make them. Just like if you look at the 10 offenses to the holy name, one of, as Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, the main offense is inattention. And to be inattentive, he said, is the foundation, the cause of the other offenses. And if you notice in your own life, you notice in the life of other devotees, when we're conditioned, we don't have a taste for chanting, and when we don't have a taste, we tend to be inattentive. And just as anything you don't like tends to be boring, and you easily get distracted. So that happens when we're chanting. Oftentimes we find ourselves, or we can see others that don't really want to be chanting, but they've taken a vow. But because of anarthas, because of offenses, which are natural because of the anartha, the inattention is there. And inattention creates distraction. Distraction is part of being inattentive. And then we're distracted because we're not really tasting the name. So you could say in one sense, offense is natural in the conditioned state, and it is unnatural in the pure state, because in the pure state there'll be ruchi, there'll be taste for chanting. So when there's taste, one naturally is focused more easily on what one has taste for. Anything, if you really have taste for something, if you really like doing something, sometimes you could find yourself doing it all day. But if we don't have taste, then we tend to procrastinate, we put it off. And those who are very determined will be able to do things they don't like. Those who are very self-controlled or self-disciplined will be able to do things they don't like. So therefore you'll find good devotees will make a valiant effort to be attentive, to be determined when they chant. But as long as the conditioning is there, at heart, it's a struggle. So because they're very determined people, or they've made a strong determination to be Krishna conscious, they'll do it. They'll do it well. But they'll do it without ruchi, without taste. So it'll be more of a struggle. And then when one has ruchi, it'll naturally, you know, one will be thinking of Krishna. So now, we had spoken a lot about offenses to devotees in the last class, last week. And the basic point was that we can say it's also our tendency to, because of pride, to offend others. And it creates a very negative environment around us, negative consciousness, which is why we are advised to avoid offenses to other Vaishnavas. So, now, interestingly, he's going to talk about something which is not so common for us in the West, maybe not even in India anymore, but let's read. The fourfold path of yoga consists of withdrawal from sense objects, pratyahara, self-control, yama, following various rules and regulations, niyama, and renunciation, vairagya. This process is not the proper means to free oneself from material anxieties. For it is difficult to attain perfection, and there is always a strong risk of falling down. The only way to become free from all anxiety is to cultivate pure Krishna consciousness in the association of Shuddha Bhaktas. Thus the jiva is freed from Maya's stranglehold and his constitutional position is revealed to the extent that anarthas have been removed from his heart. The only way to become free from all anxiety is to cultivate pure Krishna consciousness in association with Shuddha Bhaktas. Thus the jiva is free from Maya's stranglehold and his constitutional position is revealed. So, and anartha is removed from his heart. So what's being described here is that some people practice yoga. So generally as a means of self-realization, a means, so you don't find that so much in the West as a means of self-realization, practicing yoga. But anyway, it's traditionally been there. So it's being addressed here because it's often used as a process of self-realization. So it's being addressed. And the interesting point that he's making here is that you can't get pure bhakti this way, but you get it through association of Shuddha Bhaktas. So, basic point is, if you do austerity, you do tapasya, you do all these things, okay. Independent of bhakti, independent of the five main practices of bhakti, then it's basically useless. It might be useful for raising you to Shuddha Sattva, Sattva Guna. It might be useful for getting you to the Sattva Guna, but it's not useful for getting you out of the modes of nature. You know, some people like doing yoga because it elevates them in the modes of nature. It calms them, it balances them, and so forth. So then it puts you in a good state. You can chant japa well. Some people find that. Some devotees find that if they do some pranayama. And naturally, controlling one's senses, it's all helpful. But independent of bhakti, all it will do is get you to sattva-gun. Maybe if you have, maybe it may get you even to paramatma, if you're actually doing it strenuously, strictly, and so forth. But of course, it was never recommended to Arjuna, it's never recommended to us, never recommended by Prabhupada. And here, what we should note is that he's saying no. Babaji Maharaj is saying no, you can't get it this way. You get it through associating with a pure devotee. That's all you need. So what maybe you could get in thousands of lifetimes, or maybe you couldn't even get it in thousands of lifetimes. And in 1/12 of a second, you get from sadhu sangha, from associating with a pure devotee. So very, very important aspect of Krishna consciousness. If we take this principle in general and discuss it, not specifically in relation to yoga and mysticism, but just in relation to Krishna consciousness in general, then what you find is often what you cannot achieve on your own, you can achieve very easily in the sangha of advanced devotees. And that's the nature of sangha. So sometimes we struggle to follow a practice, or we struggle to achieve a certain level within a practice, and we may struggle for months, weeks, months, years, and often what we'll find is by sangha we may achieve that position almost within a few moments or very, very quickly. Sometimes we also find that we're trying to understand something in Krishna consciousness and we don't understand it well. Or we misunderstand it, and we think we understand it well. And by the sangha of devotees, we realize either what is the siddhanta that I didn't understand, or we realize I thought I understood, but I didn't. I had it wrong. So both ways, sangha is invaluable. And oftentimes when a devotee was weak, and they were close to Prabhupada because they had some important service, and Prabhupada would allow them to travel with him as a means of getting purified, or he would suggest that they travel with another sannyasi just to get association. His association is magical, it's mystical, it's powerful, and it's one of the most purifying aspects of Krishna consciousness. And again, oftentimes when we are just, in a corner and we don't know how to get out of it and we're just struggling with something, oftentimes the only thing that will help us is sadhu sangha. Just by being around devotees, especially advanced devotees, what happens is this: the effects of the lower modes of nature, they just vanish, they become purified. And often when we're struggling, what we're struggling with is the influence of the lower modes of nature. And we just sometimes just need something to shake us up, and it's that association that gets us out of the modes of nature. Because association, often how it works is just inspires us in Krishna consciousness. And if we're inspired, then naturally everything will come very easily, because when we're inspired, we practice Krishna consciousness well. If we practice it well, it works. And so often part of the problem is we're just not inspired to practice. And so we remain in a lower consciousness, or we remain in Maya, just because there's no inspiration there to really push ourselves, to really follow the process well. I see this in japa a lot. One of the biggest problems to chanting good japa is simply that we don't try hard enough. There's not enough inspiration there. And a lot of what I see happening in japa workshops and retreats is just giving the devotees through the courses, through the sangha, the inspiration to make a greater effort to chant well. And simply because of that, their chanting improves, and because of that, their Krishna consciousness improves. And then when your Krishna consciousness improves, then naturally you have more inspiration yourself. And then because you have more inspiration, naturally you chant better. Right? So, and it works the other way as well. That when you're not inspired, then you don't execute Krishna consciousness well. And then what happens? You don't do well. You battle with the modes of nature. So it's a downward spiral which works against us, and it's an upward spiral which works for us. So which one would you rather be on? The upward or the downward? But we're the ones who will generally put ourselves on the upwards or the downwards. So, Bhajanath asks a question. Can people with no trace of anarthas be termed liberated people? And then Babaji quotes a verse from the Bhagavatam. It's the 6th canto, 14th chapter, text 3, 4, and 5. Translation, O Lord, there are many jivas in this world as there are as many jivas as there are grains of sand. Only a few of these are human beings, amongst whom only a few direct their efforts in search of a higher goal. Of those who are endeavoring for a higher goal, only a few rare individuals seek liberation from this world. And out of thousands of such people, hardly one is actually able to achieve siddhi, yogic perfection, or mukti, liberation. Amongst millions of perfected yogis and liberated souls, it is difficult to find a single peaceful great soul who is fully dedicated to seva of Sri Narayan. Therefore, Narayan's bhaktas are very rare. A person free from all anarthas is known as Shuddha, as a Shuddha bhakta. Such bhaktas are very rare. Indeed, even among millions of muktas, one can hardly find a single bhakta of Sri Krishna. Therefore, no association in this world is more rare than the association of Krishna's bhaktas. So the question was, can people with no trace of anarthas be termed liberated people? And in answer to his question, he's speaking of the rarity of a Vaishnava, and meaning Vaishnava is truly liberated person. So he's saying, you know, if someone doesn't have any anarthas, can he be liberated? And Babaji Maharaj is saying, very rare. And if one has no anarthas, then he's considered a Shuddha Bhakta. And Shuddha Bhaktas are extremely rare amongst millions of people. You can hardly find one. So Bhajanath asks, does the word Vaishnava imply a bhakta who has renounced family life? Babaji, a Shuddha Bhakta is a Vaishnava, whether he is a grihastha or a sannyasi, a brahmana or a chandala, rich or poor. A devotee is a Krishna Bhakta to the degree that he has Shuddha Krishna Bhakti, pure devotion for Krishna. Bhajanath, you have already said that there are 5 types of jiva in Maya's stronghold. You have also said that bhaktas performing sadhana bhakti and bhava bhakti are under Maya's control. At what stage are bhaktas Maya Mukta, liberated? Good question. When are we liberated? Babaji Maharaj says, one is freed from the clutches of Maya from the very beginning of his devotional service. Interesting. But Vastu, Gata, Mukti, or complete liberation from the 2 material bodies, gross and subtle, is only obtained when one reaches the stage of maturity in sadhana. Before this, a person is liberated to the extent that he is Swarupgata, aware of his constitutional position. The jiva achieves Vastugata, complete freedom from Maya, only when he is completely disassociated from the gross and subtle bodies. The stage of Bhava Bhakti dawns in the heart, in the jiva's heart, as a result of practicing sadhana bhakti. When the jiva is firmly established in Bhava Bhakti, he gives up his gross and subtle bodies and becomes established in his pure spiritual body, chit sharira. Consequently, the jiva is not fully free from Maya's control, even up to the beginning stage of Bhava Bhakti, because a trace of the conditioning of Maya always remains as long as the jiva is performing sadhana bhakti. The authorities in our line have carefully considered sadhana bhakti and bhava bhakti and have included bhaktas practicing both these stages amongst the five stages of conditioned souls. The materialist and the impersonalist are definitely included among the five categories of conditioned souls. So what he's saying is, if you take to Krishna consciousness, you're considered liberated. But it's a different kind of liberation. It means there's no, you're not producing any more karma in your actions. If all your actions are engaged in Krishna consciousness, you're not producing any more karma. So your actions are liberated, but your consciousness may not be liberated. You may still identify with your body. Not that you may, you will. And therefore, you're not fully liberated, and you will have some material conditioning still there. So as long as the material conditioning is still there, you're not considered fully liberated, but your actions are liberated. So we therefore say anyone who's fully engaged in devotional service is liberated. And just like we say anyone who's fully engaged in devotional service, who's serving Krishna without any motive, is engaged in pure devotional service. And we can say also the person's a pure devotee, but he may not be situated on the platform of pure devotional service in the sense that he may have material conditioning. So he's engaged in pure devotional service, but he may not be situated on the platform, constantly on the platform of pure devotional service. And then Babaji Maharaj says, even up to the stage of bhava, you're still practicing sadhana, and there's still some slight material contamination. And therefore, you're not considered liberated, strictly speaking, until you're on the stage of prema, where contamination is finished, there's no need for sadhana anymore, no need for practice, but now you've achieved love of God. So that's the stage of complete liberation. So we have two definitions, broader definition and more strict definition. And many times you will see when a Prabhupada defines something, he may define it either with a broad definition or he may define it with a strict definition. So sometimes devotees may go with the broader definition and sometimes devotees may go with the stricter definition. Generally, I would suggest we go with both definitions. We understand it's a continuum generally. Many things that Prabhupada describes are on a continuum, and there is a definition which is more encompassing of sadhana bhaktas and a definition which is only, it was restricted to Mahabhagavats. And so sometimes there's confusion, especially a lot of confusion about pure devotional service and pure devotee. One should be a pure devotee, the guru should be a pure devotee, and then on the other hand, we say, well, we're conditioned souls. We're not pure devotees. But by definition, a pure devotee is one who engages serving their guru only for the desire to please him, only with the desire to please Krishna. That's a pure devotee. So we have so many pure devotees, and we discussed this in former classes. Prabhupada was asked how many pure devotees are on the planet? And Prabhupada said, how many devotees in ISKCON? They gave him the number. He said, that many pure devotees are there. So Prabhupada was, he was very fond of the fact that his disciples would do whatever he asked. And he would say, yes, they all completely are surrendered. They'll do anything I ask. That means they're pure devotees. So even in the conditioned state, we may be liberated. We may be pure devotees and liberated from the influence of karmic reaction, at least not creating anymore, and transcendental. Although we, our consciousness may not be transcendental, the activities are transcendental. So let's continue. The path of deliverance from the clutches of Maya is bhakti for Sri Hari. The jiva has been put under Maya's control because he is offensive to Bhagavan, and the root of all offense is forgetting that I am Krishna's servant. The offenses can only be eradicated if one has Krishna's mercy. Only then can one be freed from Maya's control. The impersonalists believe that one can gain liberation from Maya by cultivating knowledge, but this belief has no basis. There is no possibility of becoming free from Maya without his mercy. So, here's an important point. How do you become free from Maya? Here it is said, by Krishna's mercy. How do you get Krishna's mercy? You engage in a service. You engage in service of his servants. Here it said, the impersonalists believe you can get liberation from Maya by knowledge, by understanding what is Maya itself, what is illusion. And if you understand it, then you will keep yourself away from it. You'll always see this is Maya. You won't engage in Maya, but that's not the actual process. That can be used within the process of bhakti. But in and of itself, it's not a permanent way to become liberated. And by definition, liberation ultimately means to be situated at the feet of Krishna. So they're definitely not going for the feet of Krishna. Personalists believe one can gain liberation by cultivating knowledge, but this belief has no basis. There's no possibility of becoming free from Maya without his mercy. So then the verse is quoted from Bhagavatam. Excuse me. It's the 10th canto, 2nd chapter, verse 32-33. O lotus-eyed Lord, those who proudly think that they are liberated but do not render service unto you, certainly have impure intelligence. Although they perform severe austerities and penances and rise up to the spiritual position of impersonal realization or Brahma, they fall down again because they have no respect for devotional service to your lotus feet. So what this verse explains, you may know that impersonalism is a negation. It's simply negating Maya, negating sense gratification. But there's no shelter at Krishna's feet. So even if you attain this state, you can't maintain it. You might be able to attain it. Excuse me. As a rare soul, you might be able to attain it, but you can't retain it, maintain it. Because you have no shelter and you're looking for shelter. It's interesting how in the material world, in our penal system, the most severe punishment is to isolate a person. But impersonalists believe that that is the highest stage of spiritual realization, is to be isolated. But if you isolate yourself, you go crazy. And these impersonalists who achieve Brahman, they go crazy and they come down because they're isolated. They merge and there's no association, so they go crazy. So he quotes another verse. This verse from, I guess, no, this is the following verse of the Bhagavatam. O Madhava, your dearmost bhaktas, who have true love for your lotus feet, are not like those proud jnanis, for they never fall down from the path of devotional service. Since you protect them, they move about fearlessly, stepping on the very heads of those who obstruct their path, so that no obstacle can check their progress. So the point he's making is if you take to bhakti, then Krishna protects you, and even the obstacles just become stepping stones. In the Bhagavatam, I don't know, I think it may be 11th canto, this verse is there, that for the bhakta, the obstacle becomes the stepping stone. So you step on the head of the obstacle, and that becomes your stairway to the spiritual world. So there is no, ultimately what this verse is saying is there is no obstacle for a devotee, because Krishna always protects those who are engaged in devotional service. And so they ultimately don't have to worry about obstacles. A lot of times we're worried about obstacles. I fear I may fall down. Okay, so fear is healthy. We should be concerned about our anarthas, our weaknesses, and we should take care of them and not give in to them and not put ourselves in situations where those weaknesses could be aggravated. At the same time, we should understand the other side, that the other side is faith that Krishna will protect me if I'm engaged in his devotional service. He will protect me. And what does that mean? He'll give me the strength to overcome these anarthas. He'll give me the intelligence to deal with them in a way that they will not affect me, or in a way that will have not enough effect on me that they can deviate me from my service or my sadhana. So that faith is very important, because I mean, if you think about it, you'll realize that this, if there's too much fear of the power of Maya, that means there's a lack of faith in Krishna's protection. Does that make sense? Because why would I be overly fearful about something if I knew I was secure? Like, let's say you live in a dangerous neighborhood, but you have a security guard, or you have an alarm system, and it's a very good alarm system, or your security is very good, so then you won't be afraid, even though there might be reason to be afraid. You've taken all preventative measures, so now you're not afraid. So, okay, it's not that we shouldn't be afraid of Maya. We should be. We should be concerned. Definitely that's true. But on the other hand, we should understand Krishna protects his devotees from Maya who have given themselves fully to him. So it's kind of like sometimes you're concerned about something, but you're not worried about it. You're just aware that it's, let's say you're going to India. Now here in Mayapur, so many devotees, especially children, are getting chicken pox and measles. So if you're coming to Mayapur now and you know that, you might be a little concerned. Have I ever had chicken pox? Have I had measles? Maybe I need to be careful. Maybe I need to get a vaccine. So you may take some precaution. So we live in the material world, so we take precautions as best we can to avoid Maya. But on the other hand, there is this consciousness that if I should have confidence that I will get Krishna's protection, that Krishna is always more powerful. Where there is Godhead, there is light. Wherever there is darkness, Godhead dispels the darkness. So that is very important to have that faith. It's very important that we don't exist in the consciousness of fear, always worried, will I fall down, will I make it? No, but even if Maya is there, Maya is attractive, we should always have this faith that if I engage seriously and sincerely in devotional service, Krishna will always protect me. And Prabhupada says that in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. He says that about the preacher. He said, Krishna will always protect the preacher. He said, you go out spreading Krishna consciousness, Mahaprabhu will always protect you. So that's true. Now, you might say, but some devotees fell down. If Krishna is going to protect us, that means he's going to protect us because, number one, we have faith in his protection. Number two, we're engaged properly in his service and properly in his sadhana. So we have to allow Krishna to protect us. So my point is that the faith comes in conjunction with our strict practice. That you should know, if you strictly practice, you spread Krishna consciousness, you serve the Vaishnavas, you do things properly, you don't have to worry, you'll always be protected from Maya. There'll never be an obstacle that will stop you in Krishna consciousness. Okay, maybe momentarily, for a moment here or there, you might slip, for a day here or there, but your forward march will never be checked. It'll only be checked if you give up properly executing devotional service. So it's very important. So The message here is don't worry about your Krishna consciousness. As long as you are properly engaged, you don't have to worry. There'll never be anything that you'll not be able to deal with. And you should know that as a fact. Okay. So then Brajanath says, how many different types of jivas are liberated from Maya? And Babaji Maharaj says, two kinds of jivas are free from Maya's control. Nitya-mukta, the jivas who were never under Maya's control, and Bhatta-mukta, those who were once under Maya's control but are now free. The Nitya-mukta jivas are divided again into two categories. Nitya again meaning always. Always out of Maya, never in Maya. So there's Aishwarya-gati, those who are attracted by Bhagavan's feature of opulence and majesty, and Madhurya-gati, those who are attracted by his features of sweetness. Those jivas who are attracted by Krishna's Aishwarya are personal associates of Narayan, the master by Kunta. They are particles of spiritual effulgence emanating from Sri Mula Sankarshan, who resides in Vaikuntha. Those who are attracted by Bhagavan's Madhurya are personal associates of Sri Krishna, the master of Goloka Vrindavan. They are particles of spiritual effulgence manifesting from Sri Baladev, who resides in Goloka Vrindavan. So this, now it's getting a little esoteric here. There are devotees who are attracted by the Vaikuntha Narayan aspect, Vishnu aspect of Krishna. And there are devotees who are attracted by the Swayam Bhagavan, Shyam Sundar in Vrindavan aspect of Krishna. And is one better than the other? Is one right or wrong? No. But one's natural attraction will be there, and one must go with that natural attraction. Now, what gets esoteric is that now Mahaprabhu has come in this age of Kali to give love of Krishna in the mood of the inhabitants of Braja. And all the acharyas, the Goswamis and acharyas, direct us to Vrindavan and tell us that the highest service is to serve Krishna in such a way, spontaneously, that you forget that Krishna is God. Which those who follow the path of Aishwarya or opulence would either disagree with or not understand. And so where it can get confusing, or perhaps the better word is interesting, is it because Srila Prabhupada and the Acharyas are directing us towards Vrindavan, then the question is, well, is that our eternal relationship? And in Vrindavan, is it that we are all meant to follow in the mood of the Brajavasis, or is it okay if we are attracted to Vaikuntha? You know, if we go in a different way, because our gurus are flowing us towards Vrindavan. And in our line, yes, Vrindavan is the goal, spontaneous devotional service is the goal, serving, following in the footsteps of the inhabitants of Brajavasis is the goal, and that's how we're being pushed. Why? That's an interesting question, and there are different answers, and I'm just going to leave it open, because there's so many different ways of looking at this, and I've discussed this with many devotees, and they've all given different answers, some of which are actually contradictory, and these are all, I only asked this question to very exalted devotees. So, let's leave it at this point, that we are being guided by our acharyas, by Srila Prabhupada, to develop Krishna consciousness by following in the footsteps of the inhabitants of the Brajavasis, and that we are being trained to worship Radha and Krishna, or Krishna Balaram. And that is the mercy of Mahaprabhu, and that's what Mahaprabhu has come to give. Now, what if someone is strongly attracted to Ram or Narayan? It's not that anyone should be discouraged. But at this point, for most neophytes, that awakening of their Krishna consciousness is not on such a deep level that they can say that I have... I'm an eternal Ram Bhakta, or I'm an eternal Vishnu Bhakta. If that happens, then of course, every relationship is perfect. Prabhupada said that. Whatever your relationship is with Krishna is perfect. But again, we are being directed to follow in the footsteps of the gopis and the other inhabitants of Vrindavan and to develop their mood. And we know their mood is spontaneous love, which is not restricted by rules and regulations, but is free-flowing. So let's just leave it at that for now. That's enough to digest. If you want to go further, you can go further. But it's very esoteric. Now, there are three kinds of Bada Mukta Jivas. Aishwarya Gata, conditioned Jivas who are attracted to Bhagavan's features of opulence and majesty. Madhurya Gata, conditioned Jivas who are attracted to Bhagavan's feature. And Brahma Jyoti Gata, conditioned Jivas who are attracted to Bhagavan's impersonal effulgence. Those who are attracted to his opulence during their period of regulated devotional service become eternal associates of Sri Narayan, the master of the spiritual sky, and they achieve Salokya Mukti, the opulence of residing on his planet. Jivas who are attracted to Krishna's sweetness during their period of sadhana attain direct service to him when they are liberated in the eternal abodes of Vrindavan and other similar abodes. Jivas who attempt to merge into the impersonal effulgence during their period of sadhana attain Sayujya Mukti when they are liberated. They merge into his effulgence and thus are completely destroyed in the form of Brahma Sayujya. So here he added Brahma Sayujya, or merging in Brahman, as another category. And the point he's making is that the devotee attains either Vaikuntha or Goloka depending on their desire, what they want to achieve. And so if we go back to what we were just saying, is that our acharyas and Mahaprabhu, this whole line, is pushing us towards Vrindavan, is pushing us to gain that taste and desire. That's the direction that they go in. The more you study their teachings, and you'll see it in this light, the more you'll see that how true this is. Now an interesting question comes, and this will take us to the end of this chapter. And this even gets more esoteric. Because as far as I understand, before this book was written, that this point had not been explained by any other acharya. So Brajanatha asks a very good question. What is the ultimate destination of the unalloyed bhaktas of Sri Gaura Kishore Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Because he said, okay, if you worship Krishna in Vrindavan, then your destination will be Goloka. If you worship Krishna in the mood of Aishwarya, Vaikuntha Bhav, in opulence and reverence, then you will go to Vaikuntha, one of the Vaikuntha planets. But now he's asking an important question because it wasn't answered. Well, what if I worship Gauranga? Because in age of Kali, since Mahaprabhu has appeared, then the bhaktas are worshipping Gauranga. In fact, it's very interesting, when Nityananda was preaching, he didn't preach about Krishna, he preached about Gauranga. So he told everybody, Bhaja Gauranga, Kaha Gauranga, Nama Gauranga, Lahude. You just worship Gauranga. You take his teachings, you take his name, you chant his name. So he felt, because Mahaprabhu is so the most merciful incarnation, if people take his name, take his teachings, then they'll get more benefit even than taking Krishna's name and teaching. So he just preached Mahaprabhu, Gauranga, take Gauranga. And so, since Mahaprabhu has come, then now we don't approach Krishna only in Vrindavan, we approach Krishna in Mayapur through Mahaprabhu. And sometimes we're told that the way we enter Vrindavan in Radha Krishna Leela is through Mayapur. And through Mahaprabhu, we get the mercy to understand Radha and Krishna. So now, because of that, and because our line is coming through Mahaprabhu, and everything we're learning is spiced and glazed with Mahaprabhu's mercy, karuna, karunaya avatirne, the compassionate avatar who's giving mercy. So now there are Gaura Bhaktas, and what's the position of those devotees? So now, very interesting discussion here. Babaji Maharaj says, Sri Krishna and Sri Gaura Krishna are non-different in their tattva, absolute nature. They're both shelters of Madhurya Rasa. However, there is a slight difference between them, because Madhurya Rasa manifests itself in two ways. One is the mood of Madhurya, and the other is the mood of Audarya. Madhurya means sweetness, and Audarya means magnanimity. Sri Krishna manifests his original spiritual form where Madhurya is prominent. And Sri Gauranga's form is manifested where Audarya is prominent. Similarly, the transcendental Vrindavan also has two divisions, Sri Krishna's abode and Gaura's abode. So, wherever Krishna manifests, either personally or his abode, they are considered Madhurya, not considered, they are Madhurya, are sweet. And where Mahaprabhu's mood is magnanimity, which means the sweetness of Vrindavan is distributed. It's given out freely. And as we know, given out to people may not deserve it. Nobody really deserves it. Very few deserve it. So this magnanimity is taking the sweetness, but spreading it. So it's considered greater. Like you have something, it's very sweet, and so we appreciate it, we relish it, we can describe it, we can glorify it, we can honor it and say that you have sweetness. The sweetness is glorious for all these reasons. But if somebody takes that sweetness, this glorious sweetness, and distributes this sweetness, that's in it even greater, because now the sweetness is being given to everyone. So that's Audarya. So Audarya means where the sweetness is distributed. So Audarya means magnanimous, magnanimity. It's even greater. The greatest thing is now given to everyone. So it said Gauranga manifests where Audarya is prominent. But now the interesting thing is being said here. Sri Krishna's abode, this means his eternal abode in the spiritual world. In Vrindavan there are two divisions. In the eternal Vrindavan, there's Gauranga's division and Krishna's division. Gauranga's abode and Gaura's abode. So, let's read about that. The eternally perfect and liberated jivas who reside in Sri Krishna's abode as his associates are attracted first to Madhurya, then to Audarya. So, it said those who are residing with Krishna in Vrindavan, in the eternal Vrindavan, because Krishna is Madhurya, sweetness, that's what predominates first. And then Audarya comes after that, it becomes secondary. The eternally perfect and liberated associates who reside in Sri Gaura's abode are blissfully absorbed in Audarya, and then Madhurya. So they're more absorbed in the mood of giving than relishing. And in Vrindavan, they're more absorbed in the mood of relishing. And then as a result of relishing, the giving comes. And in Gaura's abode, they give, and the result of giving, the relishing comes. So now he's referring to both these devotees. Some of them reside in both abodes simultaneously by expansions of the self, while others reside in one spiritual form in only one abode and not in the other. So now he's talking about the devotees when they go back to Godhead, and he's saying some devotees have two forms. It's one soul that's divided, so it's one person. And in the eternal abode of Vrindavan, they are there with Krishna, but there's also the eternal Gaura's abode, and they're eternally engaged in the Leela of Gaura and in the Leela of Krishna simultaneously in two different forms, because to engage in the Leela of Gaura, you require a different form than you might be a gopi in the Leela of Krishna, but in Gaura Leela, you might be the sannyasi in a male form. It gets even more interesting as we read. Those who worship only Sri Gaura during their period of sadhana only serve Sri Gaura when they achieve perfection. While those who only serve Sri Krishna during their period of sadhana serve Sri Krishna on achieving perfection. However, those who worship the forms of both Sri Krishna and Sri Gaura during their period of sadhana manifest two forms when they attain perfection and reside in both abodes simultaneously. The truth of the simultaneous oneness and difference of Sri Krishna and Sri Gaura is a very confidential secret. So, currently in the Gaudiya Vaishnavism, everyone is worshipping Krishna and everyone is worshipping Gaura. So, according to Bhaktivinoda Thakur, those who are in this line, who are worshipping Gaura to get to Krishna, will go to both abodes. So we will eternally reside. If you are ever thinking, well, I'm attracted to Gaura Lila, I would like to be in Gaura Lila, the Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying, yes, you will be, and you will also be in Krishna Lila. Both Lilas are there. Now, as I said earlier, as far as my understanding goes, that this was never taught before. Bhaktivinoda Thakur revealed this to the world in this book, Jiva Dharma. So, and I believe it's true because he says here, this is a very confidential secret. So perhaps it has been revealed, but my understanding is that he revealed it. Krishna revealed it to him and he revealed it, or he already had come from that position, so he understood it. Anyway, whatever the case may be, it has now been revealed to you. So we have three more paragraphs and then we'll finish class. When Brajanath had heard all these teachings about the state of the jivas who are liberated from Maya, he could no longer keep his composure. Brimming with emotion, he fell down at the elderly Babaji's lotus feet, crying profusely. Babaji Mahashaya picked him up and embraced him. It was already quite late in the night. Brajanath took leave of Babaji Mahashaya and went home, totally engrossed in meditating on Babaji's instructions. When Brajanath reached home, he took his meal, and while doing so, he warned his grandmother sternly. Grandmother, if you want people to see me here, stop all this talk about my marriage. We're trying to get him married. It's part of the story. He doesn't want to get married. So he's saying, if you want me to stay at home, stop talking about my marriage. What's happening? Brajanath is very absorbed in Krishna consciousness, and he wants to be fully engaged in Krishna consciousness, and he knows that if he gets married, he'll have to spend time maintaining his family, and he just wants to utilize all his time for Krishna. So although his family wants him to marry, he's decided that he wouldn't marry. He decided that he just wants to engage fully in Krishna consciousness. So he's saying, Grandmother, if you want me to be here, stop all this talk about my marriage. Do not keep any sort of contact with anyone, with this Vaini Madhava. Vaini Madhava was trying to coerce him into getting married, even cheat him into it. Brajanath's grandmother was very intelligent. Understanding Brajanath's mood, she decided to postpone any question of marriage. From the kind of sentiments that he is displaying, she thought, if he is forced too much, he might leave for Vrindavan or Varanasi. Let Bhagavan decide as his will. And we saw this in the story of Raghunath Das Goswami, that his parents were very wealthy, and so they arranged for his marriage, and they took care of him financially. And he had become attracted to Mahaprabhu's movement, and he just wanted to join. Run off with Mahaprabhu, and Mahaprabhu said, no, stay at home and just do your duties in Grihastha Ashram, take care of your parents and so forth. But it was very, very painful for him. And he showed, his parents married him, but he showed no signs of any attachment for household life. He was already absorbed in prema of Krishna, so naturally there'd be no attraction for things of this world. So it was very, it was actually very distasteful sometimes. You know, Grihastha ashram is an ashram which for most people is necessary and for most people is very beneficial because it allows one to fulfill whatever material propensities one has in a way that one can advance in Krishna consciousness. But if one doesn't have that nature, doesn't have those propensities, then it's not helpful. Then it becomes more of a botheration or a disturbance. So that was Raghunath's position. But anyway, on Mahaprabhu's order, he was married, but he was always trying to escape to join Mahaprabhu. And one time his mother said, well, why don't we tie him up? Because that way he won't escape. And his father's a devotee. His father said, he has a beautiful wife, and we're giving him all the wealth that he needs. He has all the comforts of beautiful home and whatever is required, and this won't bind him up. So how are, you know, the things that would actually bind a man to a family and wife aren't binding him. So what's the use of tying him up? So it shows that when Krishna consciousness reaches a certain point, then everything material becomes distasteful. And it's so this story is so nice because Raghunath Das Goswami had everything that anybody could want. I mean, his wife was gorgeous. He didn't have to work. He had all the wealth. Not all the wealth. He had more wealth than he could possibly use. His father was extremely rich. He had servants. He had everything. He had it all. By material standards, he had everything. But because of his Krishna consciousness, it was absolutely distasteful to him because it was getting in the way of his relationship with Krishna. So it's an interesting instruction. It's like anything that gets in the way of our relationship with Krishna will be distasteful for us, no matter what it is. So let's say, you know, a naturally young boy is attracted to a young woman, beautiful young woman. So let's say a devotee boy connects with a gorgeous young woman, and she's fabulous, comes from a fabulously rich family. But let's say he can't handle it, and as a result, he becomes madly attracted to the point where it's undermining his Krishna consciousness. And he's becoming lazy, he doesn't have to work, he's spending money on sense gratification. This becomes an obstacle for him. So naturally, ultimately, he'll realize that these things, these material things, which are so giving him so much sensual pleasure, become the cause of his misery because they hurt his spiritual life. They interfere with his relation with Krishna. So that's how we understand. That's how we understand this principle. I mean, it applies even in the conditioned state. We're talking about Raghunath Das Goswami, but even in the conditioned state, it applies. Even for us. But what to speak of Raghunath Das Goswami? So, you know, Krishna consciousness is so sweet, and it's transcendental to anything material. And so this story shows that here is a person who has everything, and he's not satisfied because he got a taste for Krishna consciousness. So what does that teach us? It teaches us, if we get a taste for Krishna consciousness, then as we were saying earlier, that no obstacle will ever bother us because Krishna consciousness always remains above all those obstacles. The pleasure, what does obstacle mean? It just means we're getting pleasure from something. You might say pride's an obstacle, okay, but we're getting pleasure from it. So any obstacle just means something we're getting pleasure from. But if there's some little ruchi taste for Krishna consciousness, then anything that takes us away from it will just be a source of extreme misery for us, no matter materially how nice it is. I mean, we could put you in paradise, put you on a beach in paradise. Servants, beautiful women, whatever you want, or if you're a woman, you have gorgeous men serving you hand and foot, whatever you want, buying you anything you want. But most likely that will interfere with your relation with Guru and Krishna, and therefore you actually become miserable. So that's the understanding. So we finish this chapter. We're going to start on another topic with the next class. I thank you for coming, and Hare Krishna to all of you. And we will see you, maybe, for the next class. I will be in South Africa, and I don't know. I suspect at the time that class is scheduled for, I will be out at the Rath Yatra, not able to do it. We will keep you informed. Thank you, and Hare Krishna.